Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Laughing Goat Coffee House, where we have a poetry reading every week, and this is one of those weeks. And we have some featured poets tonight, Mark DuCharme and Andrew Schelling, that are going to go on at 9:30 approximately. Till then, we have an open reading.
This is my think piece. Can poetry matter? Can poetry matter? Can our poetry matter? Can our open mic poetry matter more than the Matterhorn stature matters to the alpinist tracker, scaling the rafters of the world for a gasp of something grander? See, we believe that by merely reading a piece, we can release beastly people from their unceasing idiocy. For we hope that our quotes will choke back the gropes of those dope smokers who tie ropes to the names of our necks on them. But there is no proof that the truths leaving our tooths can soothe the crucial pains of the youth any more than a Christian prayer. For it's at its barest that our lips as lost in superstition as the redneck thighs we hypercriticize in our anti-Condoleezza anthologies. So why fight the fact that we're but supplicants ranting against the tense, dead silence of thoughts left in notebooks, dropped in closets, waiting like cows in the stable at our cafe tables to pour our prose poem piss in the shifting sands of the world's unlistening ditches, never knowing its effects, if it protects or how it affects change, for there is no scientific method for poetry, at least not yet. Thank you.
Good evening, Jeremy.
Good evening, Jeremy.
Great. All right, this one's called Yeah, Screw It. Let my mind / memory hardware be screwed by a gluttonous monstrosity of binging. Let my out-of-control hormone organelles be screwed by every woman's lack of libido. Let the walls that belong to this coffee shop be screwed by miniature flying saucers called dirty words. Let the denizens who want to decapitate my consciousness be screwed by poison in their coffee. Let the girl who I don't want, who I never will have, be screwed by someone who doesn't want her. Let the streets that grow like blobs on the back of someone with elephantitis be screwed by hurricanes. Let the great outdoors be screwed by libertarians, presidents, and oil suck-suck machinery. Let's screw and be screwed by our dramas. Let's screw and be screwed by garbage. Let's screw and be screwed by the phrase, fuck it, man. Let's screw and be screwed by the knowledge that poetry is a dead art. Let's screw and be screwed by Nike, Borders, and IKEA. Let's screw and be screwed by Boulder's crap art. Let's screw and be screwed by our dissatisfaction, and let my pessimism and superiority be sodomized righteously by my audience who will tell me that there is hope in the Lost Generation, Part 2. Yeah. Hold my hand at the go-go, young girls fluff their hair and whip us. Tits of inferno splendorize the illegitimate lust I have for the brunette to the right. Hold my hand at the go-go as I lean on bathroom pipes and puke on the tiled floor, moaning at the sight of bile gore. Back in the main room, I can't stand the cell phone espionage. The tall men know my love isn't for real, and that I'm looking for a hole to fall down, just like a squirrel by the freeway at high time for death. This is like learning to fly, but taking a wrong turn straight into the Twin Towers.
Well, that was Jeremy. Let's hear once more for Jeremy. Last year and the year before, Jeremy made me feel good that there are young people still writing poetry and interested in coming to read it, you know, and gave me hope for this series. You know, not that the people, you know, that there was new people that were growing up that would still want to come here and read, and so thank you, Jeremy, for that. He's old enough to vote and be drafted, old enough to be vote and go kill people in Iraq, but not old enough to buy a 3-2 beer at 7-Eleven, so country trusts him with a gun and a vote, but not a beer. Let's have a nice warm welcome for Max, who appears to be in the same age category. Let's have a nice warm welcome for Max.
One color above the rest, but under every other, as all things are, toppling over to cover a lovingly stunning circumference of infinite distance surrounded by nothing you can't tell the difference. When we depend on first impressions, which we really can't remember, the censors won't let us. They don't see the genius in the deep effect of chaos on the psyche. Devious pieces of reasonable doubt, cowering without probable causes on the agenda, pending cases, wasting time of likely behind-the-scenes montage of a good dream when it unequally depicted on the screen, determining subliminal wall-to-wall expectations. Patience plays a major role in understanding ancient civilization, statements of misunderstandings of just another waste of time when your punchline is caught is a right hook and the profit that you make is only off what you took. It's just the paranoia that was toying with you, brewing up another dumb enough excuse. Misuse is just invention. Under certain circumstances, a chance will always pass you by before you see the opportunity. So dream enough to keep touch with reality. This as such will never beat the fantasy. Craft construct so you can tear it down again. Mix and blend. There is no unknown color. One color above the rest, but under every other. What you needed was a black and white reminder.
That was Max. I had too much caffeine today, so that'll lead to all these long introductions. But I thought I'd tell you guys, this guy, Don Bowles, who was the drummer in the punk band The Germs, which disbanded in 1980 when the lead singer killed himself. He was also in a band called 45 Grave and quite a few other bands. He's a year or two older than me, and he got pulled over in his van in Newport Beach, California a few weeks ago, and they're holding him on $25,000 bond because he had a bottle of Dr. Bronner's hemp oil soap in his van. And they have him in California, and they want to try him on like possession of like 5 ounces of hemp oil, you know? And he can buy this. They tore his van completely apart, and he looks like a total freak and a weirdo. But you know, they you can buy this hemp oil soap at Ideal Market or Wild Oats or any natural foods market in California. And they're trying to make it stick, and they won't let him out of jail. And you know, he's a weird guy, but he's never broken any laws. So you know, if you go on to the website for Don Bowles, if you go look on Google for Don Bowles, B-O-L-L-E-S, it'll help show you how you can write letters to your local congressman or his local congressman to try to get him out on less than $25,000 bond. And next we have Clint, who's a school teacher and a good guy, author of a recent book. Let's have a nice warm welcome for Mr. Clint Block.
This first poem is inspired by Gabriel Marquez. It's called Santiago Nassar. Love's a bit like falconry. How we're all at the mercy of pueblo and palm trees. How we're covered by grace and by feathers. And how it flaps and explodes and then flies away. And the loss of love's a bit like silence. How we're shocked at the sudden and blinding expanse. How we're lost in enormity of a black hole sort of trance. Like the arrival of knives in a big brown boat. The gesticulation on the tepid brown waves. And Santiago bleeds at the foot of his door. And I've never seen so much blood in one place before. But blood spills out in a clockwise motion. Always in clockwise motion. And spreads beneath the water. Santiago Nassar never should have worn white today.
It's called Then. Suddenly, it dawned. The ceiling opened and we were swimming below the light, converging the globe, the sun, and the rotation again to bear each other. It never changes. At the Great Wall, Lipo contemplated war. Hun snuck their fire around the edge to meet its silence. Now, and the bones are borne up, white, dissolving into morning. Thanks.
And our last open reader tonight is Brooke, who recently relocated here from Austin, Texas. Let's have a thunderous welcome for Brooke.
Hi, How's it going? Oh, really? Okay. So I was born with excessive amounts of smoke in my voice, and then I get a cold. It's over. So I'm just gonna see what I can do here. How's it going?
Great.
All right. Okay. Born. I'm not breaking. I am not breaking like glass tears falling from the pink chandelier at dusk, crashing on the sharp rocks below. My eyes do not flutter like mad moths at the sound of the gunshot. I outwit straitjackets. I walk like a flesh phantom down the lane of the Nile, smiling like a black cat, smiling like I am so pleased to meet you, like I am so pleased to eat you, my delicious dove. Like this is the first time I have sipped your strange milk and worshipped at your opal-eyed wings. This is the way we sing when we have nothing left to say, just chewing the lewd plum. I am my own mother. I am my own lover. That is what it means to be a woman born.
One of them's normally $12, and they'll be posting a digital video of this reading on Dylan's website, www.myspace.com/WTWAB. And you can see all the readings there on that website. Our first feature is Mark DuCharme. He's the author of Infinity Subsections on Meeting Eyes Bindery Press 2004 and Cosmopolitan Tremble Pavement Saw Press 2002.
Okay. I'm roughly going to go chronologically, not necessarily from poem to poem, but in terms of book or writing project to the next one. So the first thing I'm going to read, I thought I would read from this book, which is for sale tonight for any of you who are interested, Infinity Subsections. I'm just going to read one poem from this. It's called A Pantoum for One Reed. And for those of you, I assume most of you do know this, but a pantoum is a Malaysian poetic form involving repetition. And Juan Gri was a Cubist painter in the early 20th century, contemporary of Picasso's, who lived in Paris and died much younger than Picasso did.
They have one of his paintings at the Denver Art Museum.
Do they really?
Permanent display.
By the way, can you guys hear me well?
Perfect.
Okay. All right. All right, so a pantoum for Juan Green. Painterly as starlight to our fleckless selves, we breed in the legitimacy of not caving in where I want you to read this. To our fleckless selves, we breed in a memory of Spanish places where I want you to read this brokenly as houses flutter, like a memory of Spanish places in which we're shuttered, brokenly as houses flutter and the stores which eat up light, in which we're shuttered like an old Malay and the stores which eat up light remaining out of sight, like an old Malay where we've never been but walk legitimately remaining out of sight, painterly as starlight. Next, I'm going to read a few poems from the forthcoming book, which is called The Sensory Cabinet.
It should be out later this year from Blazevox Books. This first couple I'll read were published in this wonderful journal called Shiny, which comes out of Denver now, and is edited by the poet Michael Friedman. You all should know this journal and love it and own it and collect it, because it's really fabulous. It's the first, I'll read a couple poems that were published in this, that are from this forthcoming book. The first of them is called Mortal Twirl. The rusted mullets were commercialized. Then we seized upon a plan to revamp Belgium, give it more zip. But I couldn't preclude choking the immortal after the bake-off went wrong. How do you summarize a thing like that? Gingerly, after a peach schnapps in Poughkeepsie. That's our story, and we're sticking to it, like sand to a child's fingers, driven over soporific plights, what wouldn't have occurred in the dark or growing static, like glasses filled with bumblebees in this dark joint rattling off reasons without miniatures. Give me your sterno liplessness, your bulging headache. I'll fake a carry-on equation of storms to hardcore ceiling madness. You wouldn't turn out for if it slipped to wander in back of the Wurlitzers like precisions of dull amps in rare economies like birds whose thinking made us care. A sunset visually tweaked all over the mordant scrim, carrying its... let me start that again. A sunset visually tweaked all over the mordant scrim, constant as a rake, carrying its weight in light arms production against fidgety templates penetrant to standing wagers without staggering up the chinoiserie or shifted interpolations of same. You couldn't write on with a firm crayon after drinks at Minty's, becoming homeopathologically vested in a cusp obtained through hermetic nerdiness. In other words, the door is in front of you and useful as metaphor, as well as other less interesting ways I myself swore off of last year when I was 17, but recently had a conversion experience, an iffy trade over or in front of the imported retorts from which I have been sifted. This next one is called Patriot as in Riot. No political commentary intended. Please offer me your country. I will not shirk. You will procure. It will all be over. I feel like your country is right for me. Can I have your country? My country is right and would be righter, upright, with your country beside it. Yes, I do love your country, for all it's worth. Can we repossess it? We can talk all you want once you agree that I now own your country. Your country is my country, but my country is not yours. You are going to have to stop the annoying habit of referring to my country as your country. My country is my country, is my country and not yours. My is mine, undermine, landmine, intertwined. Last one I'll read from the forthcoming book is called Some Titles Thrash. The clip-on stigmata were justified. The human sideshow wants you to go to the wants you to go to lunch. Using words like jettison or Rorschach will get you exactly one free popsicle in the carnival of broken mirrors. Listen, kid, the bleepers were on auto. The whole enterprise is thrashed. You just didn't experience it consistently.
Dear successive wrestlers, resolve hyphenation trauma using the arcade of stock images in uneven buckets slumming toward a firmament at Plexi Mart. You didn't take me to the Rose Quartz Opera, Johnny Sacco. Your dossier could use a pick-me-up. Get your hands off me. I see the light rising over the Louvre like buckets of molten tin. Your new pal says, can I borrow $5 till nevermore? While you were out, Armani or his brother called, succinctly urgent that you get those spots off tie. The fake divination gave you an excuse to leave the psycho ward. Fetishistically unwise, says your spiritual advisor, but my trombonist sea captain friend thinks it's an excellent day to go to the movies. Let them eat shorts. That view of the lake still stands. Remain behind police line, but the lines remaining swell like pythons, as O'Hara wrote in a succinct example of factual anarchy. My documentation machine's all curvy, privy to extrinsic tatters, torn to ash like a missile shield windfall. Escape the fatal stony glint from the love machine of John B. Stetson. Pull up a chair. It's no use, babe. We'll see you later, but it isn't better. Vandalized by important summations. Lose the hairpiece. All is turning. Okay, and now I'm gonna read from more recent work, starting with a somewhat recent series called Inappropriate Content. And the first poem I'll read from that, it was just published recently in this lovely magazine called Vanitas, which comes out of New York, and which every other poet I think I've ever known is included in this issue, which is fabulous. This is called, thanks, John. This is called What Persists. A leaf prohibits the general economy like instances of sinking. At bottom, we are somewhere else. Place names remain thwarted. The yield was also brightly thwarted. Its pure bravado ravished geeks like an out-of-body experience by proxy, invasive, not yet framed. I had continued to question the rules of this slippage, fragrant with coercive economies bloodying schools of thought, implied but not yet rounded up to silence. Where thrusts grew more rank with clanging mock-ups which would rock us, shattered like the bottom line of the poem, which is often not the same as its summary. Yet was I still called away from the gala doldrums where I kind of stank at the notion of what's now in motion, exiting histories we have yet to grow more pale. This next one is actually a poem about skipping a reading by a good friend on the 4th of July on a rainy night and renting a Russian horror film instead. It's called There Is Something Original About This Message. In the poem of this film at night, brake lights revolving, forgotten like their use at night, in the ware of what can quickly swerve to go there, here, outside of what is flaunted by horrific looks. A prophetic revolving, though beautiful, as some women curled up, stranded in the air. Emptiness pressed between fingers, mangled to foist it off at first, like peculiarities of gunslingers on the anniversary of a poet's death, at which some women curl up in your hair, lacking fireworks which bear repeating in the dialectic of what struts through night's forgotten uses. Until Gertrude Stein delivers levers to the reading I am missing, who still somehow invents singing, forbidden repeats. And of course, the 4th of July is the anniversary of Ted Berrigan's death, the poet Ted Berrigan. Today's the day after Easter, and last April, I had a reading also in April, in that month, shortly after Easter. And that Easter, I wrote this poem, so I thought it'd be fun to read it, and I read it at that reading. So I thought it'd be fun to read it again tonight. Don't worry, it's not religious, but it's called Easter for Westerners. The azalea murderer took a power nap. She was told not to leave them in the arrears with flowers shunting, where Auntie and Peter do not have a concept. And something spills outside of taunting until the women veer like a 10-year-old tentatively structured as news causes thought but reconstrued. To mingle in apparently Buddhist robes should not be startling. Let the memo-less twist. Look at them. The chemistry is played out. It's not at every hour that one sees such backsides. This next one, and by the way, we're still on poems from this project, Inappropriate Content. This next one, I have a good friend, the poet Laura Wright, and she and I sometimes give each other assignments. So this was an assignment she gave me to write a poem with this title, and it's hard to explain how this came up, but it had to do with something the poet Paul Hoover said at a reading, I think it was last year or the year before. So this is called The Absence of Jello, and it has a epigraph by the poet Clark Coolidge, a laugh and with it a pumpkin. The Absence of Jello. The presence of anemones is a kind of flame, a decision to bail out projecting semblances into the matter until saying is as practical as glimpsing. These hindrances were pre-recorded while the narrow combo jangles up at least to an onrush, a whole point of tuning out or turning in to flame. The self is a kind of wicked stepsister. I scrawl on her tunic of bones, reified by all sinuous primping, like the twisted listeners who never veer. It takes its title from a movie. It's called In the Realm of the Senses. It was too hard, beauty, not to consume a rant positioning the evening hours at scenes of accidentally brutal youth where the teacup moon is suddenly more frail. That clinging, one becomes less checkered in the night with beautiful strangers to wield in heat while still bumped off. Melting now to underscore botched comparisons of jag. The permanent are less contrite, delaying what was slain. Flittingly as our next of kin do backflips while the imploded, asserting what was vertical, are boneless, underscored. Group of poems I'll read. Way over time. Jesus.
No, you started at 10 after.
Started at 10 after. Okay.
Yeah.
Last group of poems I'm going to read are depending on whether I decide to go out of chronological order or not at the end. The rest of these are all from even more recent work, and these may or may not be part of a project in progress called Projections. The first of these is called Seasons. One, the snow is filled with night. We still can't see the air at night, which reflects upon our tongues. Intermittent at a gape of neon, to seize just what I mean, or watch these women reappear as still as clouds must smoke. Two, it denudes by summer with their going out, to what delivers levers or trinkets launched at upstarts, who know what birds must be but skim the geometry of what's still not stable, etched against noon sidewalks like fierce deciders flinching. I think deciders. This next poem is my good friend, the poet Jack Collum, has a poem. And Jack, those of you who don't know him, he's like 75 years old, and he doesn't really know what a PDF file is, which I think most of us do. And he has a poem, though, that and he heard this term from Darren Mueller, who's a mutual friend of ours. And he has a poem using the letters PDF, you know, as sort of the first letter of each successive word. So I wrote a poem using this form of Jack's, the title is Acrobatics, which I suggest might be a good name for this poetic form. So this is Acrobatics after Jack Collum and for Darren Mueller. And I took some liberties here, but that's okay. Premeditated distillery formalism prohibits decider foolishness. Projections yet dissolved in flesh. Private drama frontiers. Paranoia destroys the future. Princess doesn't flirt. Paradise determines flippancy. Programmatic dervish fingering doth protest death march fever. Potable as in any denouement flashback. Preventative downtown femininity. Oh, poetically deviant fan base. Pucker up and do not fear. Presume death also farts. This next one is a sonnet. It's called Popular Belonging. Made a list. Questions of service identity in popular occult crooning. It occupied the space of a muckraker, as if a tributary of the lack of hours in a day could frighten into being what still construed to dare not say it's the season to be tampered with, and why not go for, at, or underneath such impact at a tone which shatters glimpsing. Though we are often slighted to its pale belief, dim with circular objects, while rushing toward in forethought to conceal these codas of imperfect guessing, objects pale or sticky with what skids. Tender as in any reflection. To exclude by what comes crashing into play, except to traumatize strangers, like anything else which this dare not bend, its stage of summer's pulsing. Yet still to bruise all laughing emergencies and whatever else continues to extend. That color of the dress you wore, the way your feet seemed, exposed by winter's manic hours. We hold these truths to be self-expressive at the impacted gulf between torch and collision, where the moon hinges on improper neon. To kiss your speech, your mirrored tongue, the brutalities of skin enclosing heat to find what's still not real, until every whisper's unfulfilled. It was the result of an assignment Laura Wright gave me. This is an assignment I gave her. She still hasn't fulfilled it, I don't believe. This is a poem called Laura's Assignment. Rage or madcap holiday. The mind is larger than private lives, but it is simple-minded never to confront them. Your assignment is to use the word bro in a poem, poignantly, sweeping thoughts aside, as if one knew another one who knew some of any more of same, leading to senses, leading to scenes it grows purported. Here is a slot. Your assignment is to fill it whimsically here. And after I showed that to her, she looked at me, and you could see the wheels turning, like, aha, I'm gonna give you this same assignment. And it's like, no, I've already fulfilled it. So, anyway, that. Just, I think, three more. This first one was written for, I can't see say he was a close friend, but someone I knew who was died much too young. I think he was about 35. Ooh, Tom, was Brad 35?
Brad Will?
Yeah.
Yeah, around there. No more than that, that's for sure.
Yeah. So he was, he died. He was kind of a journalist fellow, and he got shot essentially for taking pictures in Mexico of something people didn't want shown.
His death was recorded on video, and if you have the stomach for it, it's on Democracy Now's website.
Yes. So anyway, which I haven't seen that video, I guess I don't have the stomach for it. But this is a poem I wrote after he died, for Brad Will. With a camera to record it, to invent, to trouble, trouble as in any reflection. Brad Will, taken from the picture, was it for truth's brutality or an accident of beauty? Let's invent heaven, since I don't believe, but let's invent heaven so Brad can be there. Brad Will, gangly enthusiasm, pirate radio on Nueva York. I told my daughter I knew someone who died last weekend, was killed last weekend. Why? For taking pictures. Why would anyone be killed just for taking pictures? I don't know why. I know why, but don't. Or how to reply. Memory is troubled reflection, troubled by imagination, by image making. Brad Will, friendly troublemaker, let's make a heaven like you saw. Let us, unflinching, remember. Order. While I'm on the subject of death, which is not a subject I write about very often, I guess all I'll say about this is this was the first poem I wrote after Robert Creeley died. It's called Because. Because I could not stop for what was no longer hidden, after the addictive necessity, therefore I do not speak, because I can, or whisper into the opening which could resubmerge you in darker nights than wheat conceal, encasing what was strange, even turbulent for a moment, because I could find you not there, but real, before drawing breath in order to linger there, because I could find you yet. We still could be submerged in it. It does not matter where it was, no more. Turn about to image. Image, which is constant change. Because I could not stop, but dared to inform the speaker of the matter, matter which encompasses us. Do I find you here, up to the wicker, steeped in lucent trafficking? For death, death to remain active in a texture, an accidental barrier. And I cannot stop until then. I'm going to read in, I think, the newest one. This is called Listen. Listen. Listen, this town isn't made out of glockenspiels. I replace bondage with bassoons to get serious, to see the color of gold in a stolen reflection. Then I remake the national anthem with unasked for logic. This hip-shaking thing is going exceptionally well here. With a twist, you cannot guess until the last 3 minutes of the film how satisfying to dream of money at the checkout stand. Until discordant thinking binds me to science with caresses too spiffy for harpoon ears. I have seen the wishers well and do not wish them well. That man is really getting into shoveling his driveway. He thinks he is shoveling poems, billions of poems. Is in our national debt or delirium? I'll be over or on top of you soon, and then these digits will fend off some prying to make the meek hideous with whimsy. I am reasonably sure this is incomplete, and there should be windows in every poem with rooms to look out of, but the great really truncate or avert my lockets. Am I among the ones who sat in on the shenanigans and simply forgot to touch base? As if such rapacity splattered love children of the romantically unstable. The odds are that it's still intense, a cadre without motherboard or airplay, whispered hair day, scattered objects, ridiculous as quotidian displacements of same. Was it all about me still looking in on that the privets were loaded with dusk? How natural a tan getaway or object delirium until I am a local subject or a household tune, and then I am a name in my household stuff which suddenly displeases me. Listen to this, an unlikely gem in my nerve settles gunfire at the paradigm shifting machinery, please insert credentials until stuffed with varying households, scattered paradigms, a tangled sense of household displeasure which irritates lists, although I do not make them, until I do, and then I run toward dusk for air, and I am burning. Thank you so much.
Let's hear once more from Mark DuCharme. Watch this reading at www.myspace.com/WTWAB. And there's a goldfish bowl if you want to chip in for the feature readers. Mark, do you know if that Ed Dorn reading's this Friday or this Thursday?
Was it last week? Or
no, there's one at the Boulder bookstore.
Friday
the 13th. So Ed Dorn, who passed away in 1999, born in 1929. His new selected poems is out on Penguin. It's called Way More West. He had another book on Blacksboro called Way West. And Ansem Hollow and a bunch of other people, Jenny Dorn, are all reading from that book for free. I'm sorry, I didn't hear that until just now. Okay, some other people are going to read from Ed Dorn's poetry at the Boulder Bookstore for free on Friday the 13th at 7:30, and it's definitely worth going to check out and say some prayers for Ansem's birthdays this week, I think, like Thursday the 12th. Once I asked him when his birthday was, and he said, "I'm not going to tell you." And I said,
why not? And he said, because then you're going to tell me what terrible person was born on that day. And I said, no, I'm not. He thought I was trying to trick him, but I really just wanted to know what his birthday was so I could say happy birthday to him. He was born on April 12, 1934. Great year for poets. And our next performer, Andrew Schelling, was born, yeah, you can clap, he'll be, I'm going to introduce him and then you can clap for him some more. Every time, maybe if I say Andrew Schelling a few times, he'll clap every time I say it. All right. He was born in Massachusetts and just got back from India where he was there for 2 months. And the reason I'm saying that, he was early influenced by Thoreau, who was also a big influence on Gandhi. And Thoreau's really big over there in India too. I never knew that until recently. He cut his teeth on poetry in the San Francisco Bay Area, where he lived from 1973 to 1990 when he moved to Boulder, Colorado. Since 1990, he has published 13 books and many other chapbooks. He's known as the preeminent translator of India's old poetry, and that you can read that in Dropping the Bow, Poems from Ancient India, which you can purchase at the Beat Bookshop, as well as quite a few of his other books. He received the Academy of American Poets Translation Prize in 1992. Two Elk Press books. Is one of the titles Two Elk?
Two Elk.
Okay, excuse me. A friend of mine has a book press called Elk Press. One of the titles of his newer books is Two Elk, Tea Shack Interior, Wild Form, Sausage Grammar, Essays, The Moon is a Piece of Tea on Roden Press, and he's the editor of the Wisdom Anthology of North American Buddhist Poetry. He teaches poetry and Sanskrit at Naropa University, where he has taught since 1990. He's currently on sabbatical, and he's our featured poet tonight, and he'll be reading here for at least the next half an hour. Let's please have a thunderous welcome for Mr. Andrew Schelling, appearing at the Laughing Goat for the first time.
Thank you, Tom. That's a great reading, Mark, wherever you are. There you are, yeah. Wonderful. Thank you for the reading. It's an interesting answer Anselm gave you about, his birthday. I'm not going to tell anybody what my birthday is, but I will tell you a little litany of some of the people born on that day. Benedict Arnold. Richard Nixon and Yukio Mishima, the sort of whacked out nationalist Japanese author who committed harakiri. I'm going to read two pieces tonight. The first one is a cycle of translations. In the 12th century India, the last great poet writing in the Sanskrit language, Jayadeva, wrote his Gita Govinda, or Song of Govinda, Krishna. And it's about a 300 verse poem. I took out about 35 of the verses trying to keep the rasa, the emotional flavor of it, intact. And I got to read these to a very critical audience in India recently. And Prabhu Parikh, an older poet from Gujarat, told me that I really kept the rasa, so I feel I can read it here. I did have a woman Sanskrit scholar who could accompany me and read the stanzas in the traditional metrical patterns. I'm not going to do that tonight. I want to dedicate the reading of this poem to all the people here who have been Sanskrit students with me, of which there's quite a few of you. Except for one word in the translation, which I'm going to dedicate to Sam Knight. It is the word brindled. Just a couple of things to know about this poem. The poet's name is Jayadeva, and he includes his own name a couple of times in the poem. He was married to a woman named Padmavati, and so you'll hear her name. A couple of Sanskrit words some of you may know: Amrita, which is ambrosia, or the nectar of immortality. once I use the term samadhi, which maybe shouldn't have to be glossed in Boulder, but samadhi is a deep state of meditative concentration on an object. And so this is from Jayadeva's Gita Govinda. I'm going to read straight through about 35 of the stanzas, which will end with some songs. Don't clap between them. Wait until the end. Okay, the Gita Govinda. Clouds thicken the sky. The forests are dark with tamala trees. He is afraid of night, Radha. Take him home. They depart at Nanda's directive, passing on the way thickets of trees, but reaching Yamuna River's secret desires overtake Radha and Krishna. Jayadeva, chief poet on pilgrimage to Padmavati's feet, every craft of goddess language stored in his heart, has assembled tales from the erotic encounters of Krishna and Sri to compose these cantos. If thoughts of Krishna make your heart moody, if arts of courtship stir something deep, then listen to Jayadeva's songs, flooded with tender music. Krishna stirs every creature on earth. Archaic longings awaken. He initiates love's holy rite with languorous blue lotus limbs. Cowherd girls, like splendid wild animals, draw him into their bodies for pleasure. It is spring. Krishna at play is Eros incarnate. Krishna roamed the forest, taking the cowherdesses one after another for love. Radha's hold slackened. Jealousy drove her far off. But over each refuge in the vine draped thicket swarmed a loud circle of bees. Miserable, she confided the secret to her friend. Radha speaks. My conflicted heart treasures even his infidelities, won't admit anger, forgives the deceptions. Secret desires rise in my breasts. What can I do? Krishna, hungry for lovers, slips off without me. This torn heart grows only more ardent. His hand loosens from the bamboo flute. A tangle of pretty eyes draws him down. Moist excitement on his cheeks, Krishna catches me eyeing him in a grove swarmed by young women. I stare at his smiling, baffled face and get aroused. Krishna speaks. Every touch brought a new thrill. Her eyes darted wildly. From her mouth, the fragrance of lotus, a rush of sweet forbidden words, a droplet of juice on her crimson lower lip. My mind fixes these absent sensations in a samadhi. How is it that parted from her? The oldest wound breaks open. Radha's messenger speaks. Her house has become a pulsating jungle, her circle of girlfriends a tightening snare. Each time she breathes, a sheet of flame bursts above the trees. Krishna, you have gone. In your absence, she takes shape as a doe crying out, while love turns to death and closes in on tiger paws. Sick with feverish urges, only the poultice of your body can heal her. Holy physician of the heart, free her from torment, Krishna, or are you cruel as a thunderbolt? The messenger speaks to Radha. Krishna lingers in the thicket where together you mastered the secrets of lovemaking. Fixed in meditation, sleepless, he chants a sequence of mantras. He has one burning desire, to draw Amrita from your offered breasts. Sighs, short repeated gasps. He glances around, helpless, the thicket deserted. He pushes back in, his breath comes in a rasp. He rebuilds the couch of blue floral branches, steps back and studies it. Radha, precious Radha, your lover turns on a wheel, image after feverish image. She ornaments her limbs if a single leaf stirs in the forest. She thinks it's you, folds back the bedclothes and stares in rapture for hours. Her heart conceives 100 amorous games on the well-prepared bed. But without you, this wisp of a girl will fade to nothing tonight. At nightfall, the crater pot moon, as though exposing a crime, slips onto the paths of girls who seek lovers. It casts a platinum web over Vrindavan Forest's dark hollows, a sandalwood spot on the proud face of sky. The brindled moon soars above. Krishna waits underneath, and Radha, wrenched with grief, is alone. The lonely moon, pale as Krishna's sad, far-off lotus face, has calmed my thoughts. Oh, but the moon is also love's planet. The wild desolation strikes through my heart. Let the old doubts go, anguished Radha. Your unfathomed breasts and cavernous loins are all I desire. What other girl has the power? Love is a ghost that has slipped into my entrails. When I reach to embrace your deep breasts, may we fulfill the rite we were born for. Krishna, for hours, entreated the doe-eyed girl, then returned to his thicket bed and dressed. Night fell again. Radha, unseen, put on radiant gems. A girlish voice pressed her, "Go swiftly." Her companion reports, "She'll look into me, tell love tales, chafing with pleasure, she'll draw me into her body. Drakshati, Vakshati, Ramsite, chafing with pleasure, she'll draw me into her body. Drakshati, Vakshati, Ramsite." He's fearful. He glances about. He shivers for you, bristles, calls wildly, sweats, goes forward, reels back. The dark thicket closes about him. Eyes dark with coal, ears bright with creamy tamala petals, a black lotus headdress and breasts traced with musk leaf. In every thicket, friend, night's precious cloak wraps a girl's limbs, the veiled affairs, the racing heart. Eager, fearful, ecstatic, darting her eyes across Govinda, she enters the thicket, ankles ringing with silver. Her friends have slipped off, her lower lips moist, wistful, chaste, swollen, trembling, deep. He sees her raw heart, sees her eyes rest on the couch of fresh flowering twigs, and speaks, "Come, Radha, come. Krishna follows your every desire. Soil my bed with indigo footprints, Kamini. You have come far. Lay these gold flaring anklets across my bed. Let yes, yes flow from your mouth like Amrita. From your breast, Kamini, I draw off the Dukula cloth. Soil my bed with indigo footprints, Kamini. Lay waste the grove, savage it with your pebble soft feet. Let yes, yes flow from your mouth like Amrita. From your breasts, Kamini, I draw off the dukkula cloth. We are no longer separate. She sings what Krishna plays, her heart drawn into ecstasy. On my breast, your hand, Krishna, cool as sandalwood. Draw a leaf wet with deer musk here. It is love's sacramental jar. Drape my loins with jeweled belts, fabric and gemstones. My moan's Venus is brimming with nectar, a cave mouth for thrusts of desire. On my breast, draw a leaf. Paint my cheeks. Lay a silk scarf across these dark loins. Wind into my heavy black, gray, white petals. Fit gemstones onto my wrists, anklets over my feet. And each thing she desired, her saffron robe lover fulfilled. Reader, open your heart to Jayadeva's well-crafted poem. Krishna's deeds lie in your memory now. Amrita to salve a dark ages pestilence. That may not be the current taste in poetry, but you know, the devotees of Krishna believe that in this dark age, this Kali Yuga, only allegiance to Krishna will see you through in black times. So, anyhow, I'm going to read one other piece. This is an anthology that just came out. I'm very excited about it. It's called For the Time Being, the Bootstrap Book of Poetic Journals. And it was edited by two former students of mine in the Kerouac School, Tyler Doherty and Tom Morgan, and published by two other former students, Ryan Gallagher and Derek Fenner, and has mostly work that is in the range of the poetic journal. 29 poets, including Jack Cullum, who I think Mark mentioned, and Shinyu Pai, who is also at the Kerouac School. There are interviews with various people. Joanne Kiger is in it. So I'm going to read the entry that I have in it, not from the anthology itself. I need it from the typescript so I can lay it out. Because this is a sequence of poetic journals, there's a lot of words that aren't mine. In fact, none of these words are mine. They're all commonly owned by most of us, but there are quotes here which I won't necessarily attribute right inside of this. Quotes from Bob Dylan, Zayami, the great Japanese dramatist of the 14th century, Wendy Hall of the Boulder Historical Society. I don't know, maybe some of you are in here too. So this is a sequence of journal entries, but as it progressed, it did something very strange, which is it turned into a no-play. Some of you may know the no-drama of medieval Japan, which is a highly stylized, ritualistic drama deeply infused with Buddhist principles and some Shinto principles, and it usually has to do with a wandering priest who locates an earthbound spirit who needs to be freed from his or her karma. So I don't know how this happened, but the journal entries began to wind around and ended up being something of a no play. So where you hear the word no, it's not the terrible twos, it's something different. This is called A Bare Windswept. A Bare Windswept Notebook. 24 October 2006. Why has ammunition gone up 50% from last year? Everything's gone up at Netherlands Ace Hardware. Not 50%. Copper has, brass, the shell casings, and these are the moons. Wolf moon. Snow moon. Worm moon. Pink moon. Flower moon. Strawberry moon. Buck moon. Sturgeon moon. Corn moon. Harvest moon. Hunter's moon. Cold moon. Closest to autumn equinox is harvest moon, but should it fall in October, September's called corn moon. 14 January 2006 at 4:48 a.m., my birthday was full wolf moon. Marlowe's is this week halfway to full hunter's moon. Elk migrating down from the high country. Cat track corn moon. 29 October, big medicine in the lyrics. Brad Wills was shot to death in Oaxaca. A decade back, he studied poetics in Europa, then worked the Latin America trail for indie media. Arrived Oaxaca City a few days earlier to document the six-month protest from a barricade. Gun battles Friday that killed a U.S. journalist and at least two Mexicans. Now Vicente Fox has sent in the federales. Retake city from protesters, leftists, demand resignation of Oaxaca's pan governor. Each came from an older world, a more ancient order, one with more piss and vinegar. They knew where they belonged and had guts to back up whatever their beliefs were. 5 November, eyes on elections in El Norte in Oaxaca. Protesters move through the university grounds to confront the federales. 9 dead thus far, the flowering spirit. And pulling up stakes in the withered tomato garden. The crimson Mont Blanc pen lost last month under year's first snow, 7:58 p.m. Full hunter's moon. 8 November, on West Slope, Green Mountain, the ranger meets the green bear. Trail names introduce a caprice of syntax, winding or twisted. The Manjushri Sadhana is only a morning song. Can it retrieve a shadow gone wandering night's tortuous trails? Shh, appeared in the dream, the six roads of winding and passing. Many Baroque rooms, a banquet set with flowers, but not food. The women solicitous, one takes my glasses when she rises to go, leaving her own. Willowy, wraith-like, pale, shadow, pliant, accusatory, spectacles. What is it I need to see? The palest gibbous moon disk is setting behind snow peaks on the ridge north of Shark Tooth. A raven with ragged plumage has followed me this sharply ascendant stretch of trail and sits croaking softly, forecasting what? That somebody's dying? The other world is not fun and games. Your shadow ventures into some uncertain sphere, hunting the absent heart. Jaime de Angelos, specter of him in the book I will write, follows me until the raven catches attention, softly hopping along ponderosa boughs. Note, interview Daryl Babe Wilson, Achumawi. Is this what the raven brought? Not Shark Tooth, but Sawtooth, that peak, which proves to sit farther south, near Audubon. The moon disk hung between Mount Copeland and Mount St. Vrain. Northwards along the crest, Alice, Chief's Head, Pagoda, Longs. When will I know the simplest arrangement of these beloved Indian peaks? How prepare for deaths of loved ones still scarcely known? Note, prepare own death. Borrow glasses. Canyon Wren. Notes dropped like falling ice through Shadow Canyon Friday. Arid and semi-arid rocky canyons and outcrops. a cup of moss, spider web, leaves, catkins on a base of twigs, fine threaded materials lining the cup. Nest, maintained, and reused. Very little studied. 5 or 6 eggs. 10 November. Resignation. Donald Rumsfeld. Peterson's on the canyon wrens, a gushing cadence of clear, curved notes, tripping down the scale, sometimes picking up at the end. Could say bluesy, the prominent minor blue note, bent, meaning curved. That the later notes are held longer. Dry rocks line the ridge. 2 November, Zayami, Genzai no, heroes going 1,000 leagues down the wrong path. Odo, Banryu, love, attachment to the past, demented psychological states, possession. Mugen, no, world of illusions, spirits, and ghosts. Mugen, dream apparition from Diamond Sutra, the concluding gatha, swapnam, dream, maya vashyaya, apparition, mu, gen. Thus all compounded things should be regarded. Avashyaya, dewdrop, avashya, hoarfrost, avashyaya, patta, frost, cloth, fine silk fabric, used for protection against frost. In Mugen no, the Waki is a traveler, often a vagrant monk whose station is somewhere between priest, shaman, and beggar. By the very fact that he journeys alone through the country, he is on equal footing with wandering spirits, street preachers, prostitutes, and those who fall somewhere in between. The tension of Mugen no, the Shite's torment, anger, and attachment to the past versus possibility of salvation through release from attachment. Transience of all things, yet the past rises up, more so the dream. 13 November, Wendy Hall of the Boulder Historical Society has turned up the story. There was a fellow named Ira Rothgerber who platted that area back in the 1950s. He owned property and a house out there. When he platted the streets, he named one McSorley and one Old Ale, both after McSorley's Old Ale, of which he was fond from his New York days. McSorley is a street off of Old Tail. The county was not thrilled with naming a street after a beer, so he changed it to Old Tail instead. This for fanatics, Old Ale, Old Tail. There is no tail for the road, nor a person named Tail, a neighbor had it, the oldest Irish pub in New York. It denied women entrance until 1970. Ronald Johnson wrote his favorite meal was McSorley's Plowman's Platter. Dark bread, a wedge of cheddar, a pickled onion, a trick of consonants, ecological sound change, Diamond Sutra, Chapter 32, Taraka Timiram Dipo, Maya Vashyaya Budbudam, Swapnam Cha Vidyud Abram Cha Evam Drashtavyam Sanskritam Gata Star Cataract Lamp, sorcery, dewdrop, bubble, dream, and lightning, and cloud, thus to be seen. All compounded things. It is a desert of the American West. in a Zen retreat center, dream, unable to leave, some glitch in travel plans, dark robes brush the pine wood floor. Kitchen has bamboo cookware, green slime on the vegetable steamer, and hard rain raking the windows. Later, we travel by bus. There is a stopover at a Rabindranath Tagore ashram, and Althea removes theft many tiny figures of human bone, the sort used by Bunpo priests for ritual aprons. She shows me a handful. The bus is our living quarters, then secures the figurines in a room marked off by sheer silk. Frost cloth? Strengthen your practice. Do not be conceited. 6 p.m. Wilting is beyond even the flower. It is the wilting of the flower that demonstrates mastery. In this world, the flower of man's heart is what fades. 20 November. Dear Shinyu, Jerome Rothenberg came to town for a reading. A few nights ago, I dreamt I'd gone close to the stage as he performed. Many huge volumes littered the floor. I saw dictionaries for archaic languages never conceived. Proto-Indo-Semitic, prehistoric Irish Etruscan, left-handed early Caucasus, Magdalenan vernacular, my eyes narrowing to a future project, tri-gendered late Algonki Kinnick-Kinnick. P.S. Even before Zayami's time, secular literature was considered as strong an inspiration as the sutras for conversion to the Buddhist way. Song. Carve up an elk. Carve up a poem. Dress out a different poem. Never deviate from the truth. 21 November, new moon, everyone dark, hidden. A notebook project should have a motif. A mora, pattern, or particular phrase to return to. A small, windswept space defined by a few pines. 24 November, climbed Green Mountain, Ranger Trail intersect with West Ridge and Green Bear Trails. Where is my raven? Last month he croaked softly and suggested was somebody dying. Now drums a warning. A note play takes shape in the small windswept space defined by a few pines. The trail up, the bridge between worlds. Notes for November 8th, raven and ragged plume, stark branch, evening, twilight. There's a lady ranger with GPS mapping undocumented trails. 1. The traces of earlier karma remain and are not readily expunged. Physically, undocumented, the only consciousness of them keeps us from revisiting ghost-like the scenes, the patterns, the flowers of hell. 2, that by oneself there's little power to expiate karma and liberate. Alignment with traditions of insight provide a path, a power beyond personal intent or ability. This is how the Dharani encompasses you, e.g. ghostly insights of Buddhist inspired know, a small windswept space defined by a cluster of pines. The ghost of furious lady are a hanya generated by past karma, separated from the personality without her knowledge, poison and thence curse, love, attachment to the past, demented psychological states, this time for the page to be read, not acted, wrapped in icy green frost cloth, comprised of madness and speech, 100 leagues down the wrong trail, notebook now named a bare windswept. 25 November. No. human life turns on an axle. The mind is channeled with sorrow as a canyon with streams. One's hold on life light as frost on the avashaya cloth. Avoi or komachi. All night I lie in a thicket. The moon lies like ice on my fury. I will not let the light touch me. Rikujo, my love cannot be restored, not even by dream. Not platinum moonlight, not detached from what's real. The raven lifts not from a withered branch, not detached from what's actual, not actual. The mind echoes with memories, as the canyon with a wren's curve notes. My hold on life more brief than this frost. A canyon rims clear, curved notes drop through shadow canyon. In dry rocks by the ridge, the bent notes raise bent images to mind. Terrible mask. Scarlet eyes. Her robe is torn down the middle. The apparition wavers on the ridge. Wind bends the green pines. The mask has turned white, 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 and in the wind whistles. Clear, clear, the curved note of the canyon wren. Canyon wren. 2 December, the common North American raven, cache food temporarily, oft burying it, break mollusk shells by dropping onto rocks from above, auk hunt cooperatively in groups, aerial acrobatics and spectacular dives said to be play, winter communal roosts in trees, auk in marsh, in flocks of up to several hundred, oft perennial, largest passerine, withered, bare, windsweep, robe torn in the middle, notebook as no play, green cloth binding the pages, country at war, icy war, often ourselves. Not retaining the seeds of the flowers you obtained at various times of your life is like holding the flower of a branch you have broken from the tree. But if you do keep the seeds, will the flower not remain as the years and seasons progress? I must repeat, do not forget the mind you had in the beginning.
Available over there. Quite a few of Andrew's books are available next door at the Beat Bookshop. Next week we have Reed Pye, Jim Cohn reading as our featured. The week after we have an all open reading, and the week after that we have K.M. Pickens and Sue Reinhart. Thank you all for coming. Don't forget to tip your baristas on the way out, and we'll see you next week, same time, same channel. Good night.